All right. Good morning, Ridgepoint Church. How's everybody doing this morning? Good. Now listen, for us to work this morning, we need some audience participation. I need some excitement, some enthusiasm. And I want to know this, by raise of hand, who's had a good week this week? All right, man, a lot of people. We had good weeks. That's awesome. I know there's a particularly strong group of people who had a really good week, and that is the New England Patriot fans. Now, we don't have many, but the few we have are very vocal about it. We're not pointing at anybody, but there's a few that even went to Disney to see the parade, I believe, something like that. But they had a really good week, because whether you're a fan or not, the Super Bowl last weekend was the Super Bowl for the ages, incredible comeback, and whether you like them or not, just to see their length of just a superior play, regardless of the other stuff, we can give them credit. Like, that's a really cool thing, and they kind of celebrated, and one of the things that I loved is just the festivities that are involved. When you saw the final play, and they started shooting paper cannons, and everything went crazy, the way that our culture celebrates football, like, it's a big deal. It's a big deal in our culture. In fact, a while back, we were having a discussion in our family group. We're kind of sitting around, we're having dinner one night, and we're kind of having this discussion, and someone brought up, one of the guys in our group brought up, said, "Man, I wish we celebrated at church the way we celebrate at football stadiums." And legitimately, I called the person out and said, "Okay, I expect you to start cheering now during my messages." But I said, "I don't think it's so much that there's a stronger passion towards football than there is towards spiritual growth." Sometimes that might be the case. But I think that more so, it just is that we've been brought up in a culture where we think there's a certain level of decorum that's expected in church, that there's a reverence about church. And so when you walk into church, there's just a certain way that you're supposed to act. And even when we come into a non-traditional setting like Ridgepoint Church is, it's kind of in the back of our mind, there's this decorum that, well, if I went to church at all, like, you couldn't get loud, you couldn't celebrate, you weren't allowed to have fun. In fact, I grew up in a church, and it was very much like this, where if a child came into the church, they had really nice pews and everything, and if a child came in and put their feet up on the pew at all, like, there's going to be some old blue-haired lady come across and, like, slap their foot down and get you. Like that's just kind of this culture that we have. And because of that, we kind of came in. And the best word that I could use to describe it is we have this mindset that, well, when I walk into church, I have to be reverent. Like, I have to be right walking into church. And so because of that, the decorum that's appropriate at a football game might not be appropriate at church. And so let's kind of take a step back and everyone settle down and let's play it safe. The problem with that is when I approach the Bible that we read about in the New Testament, the church wasn't, those weren't hallmarks of the church. They weren't concerned with being reverential or having a certain level of decorum. The words I'd use would be words like alive, words like present, words like dynamic. And we've kind of settled into a spot in our culture where we just expect church to be safe. And so it's kind of walk in and be quiet and be staid and everyone settle down and no one get too excited and everything's going to be okay. When I think that maybe our response during a football game might be more appropriate. Maybe if we get more excited about this stuff, get more excited about spiritual growth. And so that being said, I want to say this. If you want to get excited during the service, if I say something you like and you want to cheer, I want you to be free to be able to do that. Like, be authentic about it, be real about it, but also want there to be freedom. So if I say something you like, you can cheer about it. If I say something you don't like, we're walking on thin ice on this one. But if I say something you don't like, listen, because it might be the Holy Spirit of God speaking to you, and that's why you don't like it. So be careful on that. But if that's not the case, and if I say something you don't like, if I say that you should cheer when I say something good, if I say something you don't like, please don't boo. That would damage my fragile psyche. I don't want that. But instead, send an email to chris@ridgepointchurch.org. That'd be awesome. But seriously, I want us to get to a spot, especially in the midst of this series, because this series is going to be different. We wanted you, when you walked in this morning, we wanted you to know that this series was going to be different. In fact, my favorite pastime this morning has been standing at the door as people walk in. Because, like, there first, if you're new to Ridgepoint Church, the aisles are not normally like this. We normally have three aisles of chairs. And so people walked in, and everyone walked in and was like, whoa. like, where do I sit now? Like, I don't know what to do. Like, we are used to going to our spot, and now it's all kind of shaken up and changed. And we want us to know that this series is going to be different. Today, we're drawing a line in the sand and saying, God, you've given us these series on vision to kick off this year. But now as we move forward from this point on, now what do we do with that? How do we maintain that from here moving forward? And so this series, we did some things a little bit different. The chairs are arranged, the decorations and all that stuff. If you're in groups, it's going to be a little bit different in groups if your groups are participating with all of that stuff. But the series Unqualified was actually started about a year ago. A bunch of us went to a conference up in South Carolina. And there's a pastor that came by. His name is Stephen Furtick. Some people love Stephen. Some people don't like him. He's very animated, very passionate. But he wrote a book called Unqualified. Now, sometimes during the fall semester, we do like a group study go along with a series where we kind of bounce off of something. We've never done this on this scale in a spring semester. But what we're doing in this series is we're taking this book they wrote called Unqualified as a jumping off point. I'm not one who likes to preach someone else's sermon or anything like that. So I kind of read the book. I said, there's some great ideas. Now let's develop our own ideas from that. So if you want to supplement that, I'd encourage you to read the book. If you want to watch some of the sermons, you can do that as well. The content is going to be very, very different from week to week. So feel free to do that. But we're using the book as a jumping off point because I believe that for us as a church, that there might be no greater point to what we're doing than what we're going to talk about for the next 4 weeks of Unqualified. That being said, one more change we had on the way in, you should have gotten some notes. If you're a note taker, I know some people have asked for this in the past. If you're a note taker, we've provided you with notes this morning. If you're not, go ahead and throw it away. You're not going to be offended at all. You can do that. But I know some people love to take notes, and some people come back, hey, I missed point three. So try to make that a little bit easier for you during this series. That being said, to our note takers, a word of caution. Because if you're like me, sometimes when someone's teaching and there's notes in front of me, I have a tendency to like focus on the notes and really not see the bigger picture of what God's trying to accomplish in my heart because I want to fill in the blanks. Like you, if you need to fill in the blanks, because here's what happens. If you're a fill-in-the-blank type person and you miss one of those blanks, it annoys you the rest of the day. Like you can't go on with life until you figure out what was number three. I missed that one, and you're over there like cheating from your partner. Like I didn't get. Listen, in church it's not cheating. You're allowed to do that. So we gave you the notes. Don't be distracted by them. If you miss one, listen to the podcast, all that stuff. But we want you to be fully engaged in this series. We want to give you as many tools as possible because I believe that this series could be for a lot of us, and I believe in the next 4 weeks for a lot of people that are not here this week. This series could be a game changer for them if we embrace some of the ideas of what we're going to talk about this morning. That being said, at the very top of the notes, I'm asking everyone to participate at least with this first one. Because at the very top of the notes, it says this. It says, I am, and there's a blank. And I'm going to give you a whole 15 seconds, 15 whole seconds to answer this, to fill in the third word in this statement. Who are you? If you could pick one word right now, today, this morning, February 12, 2017, at 11:20 in the morning, who are you? One word, 15 seconds, go. Time's up. How many of you would be honest and say, I struggled with picking one word because I had no idea what I was going to write? Okay, good. I'm glad there are a few at least. Because when we answer this question, filling in the third word, this is an emotional decision. Because today I might feel like something because there are a lot of qualifiers to fill out that last thing. I could answer a lot of things. Today I could say I'm a husband. I'm a father. I'm a son. I'm an uncle. I could talk about my job. You could talk about your job. You could say I'm a firefighter or I'm a police officer. You could talk about that I am, spiritually speaking, we're in church. So I'm imagining a church. Some people provide a spiritual answer. I'm a son of God. I'm a child of the King. Maybe some just wrote your name and said, my name best describes who I am. But the thing is, this is emotional because today I could feel really good. Today, I could be knocking out some things in my life. I could say, man, this week I've been working on eating healthier and working out, and I hit the gyms 4 times this week, and I didn't cheat on my diet. And so because of that, I would say this morning, I am successful. And then I could go out tomorrow, and I could cheat on that diet. And I'd go out to the best barbecue place in town and order the biggest meal and say, bring extra meat. I need some food. And then when the waiter comes and says, would you like dessert with that? You say, yes, I would. And I blow it all. The next day, I say, I am a failure. This is an emotional thing because often who we are is defined by, or we define ourselves by, the things that we do. And so because of that, when we have success, we feel really good and we feel like, man, I'm powerful. I'm knocking this thing out. But when I fail, and it doesn't take a lot of failure in my life for me to start to have doubts. I could be killing it all week long. And then someone says one thing critical about me. And I feel like, man, I lost it all, my week shot, because of this one critique that was misplaced. So this is an emotional thing. We're actually going to talk about this a little bit more next week, but this idea of who are we? Where do we get that? But in today's talk, we're going to talk about two different ideas, two different things that we want to hit on. The first one we're talking about is competency versus character. This idea of competency versus character. When I talk about this idea of competency in particular, because we're going to spend the rest of the time talking about character, but when I talk about competency, I talk about the things in my life that make me seem proficient. And there's nothing wrong with either of these. Both of these qualities are good. We should really work really hard in our life at being both competent, but also being people of high character. The problem is, where we're at right now, is that we tend to place a higher premium on making sure we're competent. In fact, we're hired at a job because we're competent. Now, we're kept at the job because of the character, but we're hired at the job because we're competent. And our whole life, we're measured based upon our competency. And this isn't something that's new. It's something that's learned at a very, very young age. There's a guy, a brilliant guy, named Sir Ken Robinson. He's an educator. He talks about education all the time. But back in 2004, he gave a TED Talk, which was a short 20-minute talks. In the talk, he talked about creativity and education, and he had this statistic that talked about the amount of children who, prior to 5 years old, were through the charts, above the charts creatively, but then after 7 years old, their creativity starts to wane pretty quickly, and the denominator was that's when they started to go to school, and they started to learn a very specific type of education where we value competency above everything else. And so they became more proficient at things like math and sciences and less proficient at things like the arts. And he started to talk about how this was true, and we're not in an education setting, but it said this is kind of where we start at a young age, is that we want to be proficient, we want to be competent at certain things, and then we take that same mindset that we learned. It's nothing against school, it's kind of how our culture is, but we take that same mindset, that pass-fail mindset. And you and I have this bad habit of applying that very same mindset to our spiritual growth. And so what happens is we learn in school that if I'm really good, it means I'm earning A's. And if I'm really bad, I'm earning F's, and no one's ever going to accept an F. But if I'm middle of the ground, if I'm earning C's and maybe some D's in there, well, then it still probably is not going to be enough to measure up. And then I start to take that same mindset that has saturated my culture, my learning culture, from the time I was 5 years old, and maybe some of my parents instilled some of those same values and some of those same virtues, and I say, now I'm applying that very same thing to my spiritual growth, and I'm finding that I cannot measure up. There's no way God could use me because of all the failures. There's no way God could use me because of my mistakes. And we place such a high premium on our competency at the expense of our character. Competency is what we do. But character is who we are. We've placed a high premium on competency, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with competency. But competency is what we do. We're hired to a job because we're proficient in some area. But we're kept at the job because we're people of high character. We're liked because we're people of high character. And as we start off this series on being unqualified, we think we're unqualified because of the things that we do. We think we're unqualified because, man, I have this past, and this past is kind of haunting me and stuff that I've never dealt with. And so because of that, I don't feel myself spiritually competent to make proper decisions, to lead my family. And so because of that, I don't feel I can step up and really be the person that God wants me to be because I've never been competent in those areas. The thing is, when we read the Bible, when we look at the way Jesus chose his disciples, When we looked at some of the stories that was even cited in the video as a precursor to this message, God chose, and Jesus himself chose people who were very not competent in certain areas. They had a past, they'd had mistakes, but their life wasn't being defined by who they were. They weren't saying, this is who I am, my past is who I am, and I can never get past that. But they're saying, because Jesus steps in and he wants to change us, he wants to mold us, he wants to get us outside of the box we've always been fit in, that because of that, I now have a chance to have character in my life. And that instead of the American mindset where if we become competent, we think if I do enough stuff, eventually I'm going to be. And so what happens is some people never come to church because they say, I could never do enough to fit in. I could never do enough to be qualified. I don't feel qualified to come to church. I don't feel qualified to be a leader because I can't do enough to get me there. But God says, no, it's reverse. It's not that you do enough to be, but you simply be. And once you be, and we're going to unwrap this a little bit more next week, once we be, then that starts to affect what we do instead of vice versa. So today I want to look at a story. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and open up to 1 Samuel chapter 16. And I want to look at a story. And maybe as we look at the story, at least you're going to be familiar with some of the key people that are in the story, especially King David. But in this story, there's a prophet. The book of Samuel is written by the prophet Samuel. And the prophet is rising up against Saul, who is the previous king, the first king. And Saul has been a king, and he's not been a good king. He's made a series of poor decisions, a series of bad decisions. Enough that God finally says, I'm done. Now, Saul was the prototypical. He's what you expect out of a king. He was strong and mighty. He had a big stature. Like, when we think, and there's something, like, intrinsically wired inside of us, that we tend to look at people on their outward appearance and judge and evaluate right away whether or not we think that person is going to be a leader or whether that person has potential. And we don't mean to do it, and we're being taught not to do this. And yet, naturally, we have a tendency, if a person walks in and they have a big stature and they look the part, we tend to think, well, that person would probably be a strong leader. If they look maybe a little more attractive, we think, well, that person might be a good leader and put them in a position of leadership. And Saul had all of that. He had the outward stature of, man, this is what we expect a leader to look like. He's a warrior. He's strong. He's mighty. This is who we expect. And yet he made a series of bad decisions, culminating with Samuel having to come and to call him out and say, God is removing the anointing from you. You're no longer going to be the king. And that's all Samuel knows. Samuel doesn't know what's happening from that, or that's all Saul knows. He doesn't know what's happening from that point on, but he knows up to this point. And he goes and he pleads, and he grabs onto Samuel and says, please take me back and teach me what I need to do. I want to serve God. And he said, no, you've had your chance. God has pronounced judgment. That's it. We're moving on. And then we pick up in 1 Samuel chapter 16. And even though Samuel had to be the bearer of it, we read that he wasn't really thrilled with that idea. Says, the Lord said to Samuel, how long will you grieve over Saul since I've rejected him from being king over Israel? So Samuel's still going through this grieving process. He said, I had to do this. I knew this was the right thing, but I didn't care to do it. And I'm grieving over the loss of my friend, of the king. And he says, you need to stop. That season's over. And he says, fill your horn with oil and go, and I will send you to Jesse the Bethlehemite, meaning he's from Bethlehem, for I provided for myself a king among his sons. And Samuel said, how can I go? If Saul hears it, he will kill me. The Lord said, take a heifer with you and say, I've come to sacrifice to the Lord, which is what he's going to do. And invite Jesse to the sacrifice, and I will show you what you shall do. And you shall anoint for me him whom I declare to you. Samuel did what the Lord commanded and came to Bethlehem. The elders of the city came to meet him trembling and said, do you come peaceably? They're afraid, like, he's coming. Is he coming as a messenger of the king? What's going to happen? What's going to take place? And he says, peaceably I've come to sacrifice to the Lord. Consecrate yourselves and come with me to sacrifice. So he calls the leaders. He calls on those people to come. And he consecrated Jesse, the father, and his sons, and invited them to the sacrifice. So he sends to Jesse, the father, and says, hey, come and bring your sons. We're going to have a sacrifice. Now, at this point, they don't know what's about to come. But he sends a message to Jesse, say, come on, bring your sons with you. We're going to have a sacrifice. It's during that sacrifice that Samuel starts to reveal, here's God's plan for the next king. Here's who I want the next king to be. And God was all about the character of the king, especially a low-character king like we had with Saul. He says, I want to have a high-character king. And so he has not yet revealed to Samuel who that king is going to be. But he says, call Jesse, have him bring his sons. And from his sons, we're going to name the next king. Three things about character. Number one, character isn't a physical thing. Character isn't physical. We see this in the next couple of verses. Verse 6, it says, when they came, he looked on Eliab. Eliab is the oldest. He's the firstborn son. He looked on Eliab and thought, surely the Lord's anointed is before him. All he does is he sees the older son, and he sees the stature of the older son. And having seen what he just saw out of the king and Saul, it said, man, Saul was a big man. He had mighty stature. And the oldest son comes, and he says, that's what a king should look like. And he doesn't take time to evaluate character or any of it. He just looks and says, obviously, this guy's competent. Look at his size. And so because of that, he says, surely the Lord's anointed is before him. But verse 7, the Lord said to Samuel, do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. Man looks on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. Samuel is guilty of this. He puts people in boxes because of their appearance more than their character. And so Eliab comes and he has the big stature and he says, that guy, surely I found the king. He's going to be the next king. And God says, no, that's not him at all. That's not who I have to be king. You're looking on the outward appearance and that's all you're seeing. But I'm looking at the heart and his heart isn't measuring up to what you're about to see. Listen, we have a tendency to do this and we don't mean to do it. But we have a tendency to put people in boxes based upon the way they look or based upon maybe some of their past choices. And we put them in a box and say, okay, I've heard this story before. Maybe you're talking to someone at work and you don't know the person that well. But they start to share their story and they start to whine and complain about certain things. And you think right away, oh, I know someone just like you. Like, I know what that's like, and I know exactly what you're going to do because you're going to act the same way that they did. And we put people in boxes. And so that's just kind of what I expect. And so if that's who you're going to be, then for the rest of my knowledge of who you are, I'm just going to keep putting you in that box. God doesn't put us in those boxes. And you and I, we don't particularly care to be put in boxes. I don't like someone looking at me and saying, well, I know someone just like you, and so I know how you're going to respond. God's made us. He's fearfully and wonderfully made us to be different and unique creations. And to put us in a box, sometimes we want to knock those boxes down and say, no, that's not me. No, that's not my story. I've been created for something bigger than this right now. And so don't put me in a box. Don't say, I can't measure up. Because when we do this spiritually, and I don't think we intend to do this, but when we do this spiritually, we hurt ourselves. Because some of you this morning have been put in a box, and it's become so comfortable just sitting in that box. You say, I'm going to sit here and be safe, and I'm not going to knock down the box, and everything's going to be safe, and everything's going to be fine just inside of that box. And God says, no, I want you to knock that box over. And even more dangerous is when we put other people in those boxes. We say, well, that person could never lead their family. That person could never beat that addiction. That person could never salvage what's left of their marriage because of their past choices. And I'm put them in a box and say there's no way in the world they can leave that box. And then what happens is people come in the doors of our churches across our country, and they're so afraid already walking in. They're so nervous walking in because they're afraid of the judgmental glares. They're afraid that someone's going to watch them. And they walk in so afraid of that. And whether it's intended or not, the judgment feels real to them. I know that because yesterday during the day, I shared a little post about what was coming up on, shared up on Facebook. And I had a bunch of people just kind of share that post. And by the time it was done, someone, I don't even know who it was, but someone underneath that post who I'm not familiar with, that we're not friends with on social media, but they commented about another church. They didn't mention the name of the church, but got more specific than I was comfortable with. But they said, oh, I went to a church in such and such a city. It was a particular denomination of church. And that's how they were. That when my family needed them the most, they laughed at us and they made fun of us. And we read that and we say, man, I'm so thankful to not be a part of that climate. But at times, do we miss opportunities? I say, man, we had a chance to impact people's lives, but because we weren't there, because we put them in a box and we said, well, this is kind of who I expect you to be, we miss chances to really impact people's lives. For the last couple of years, I've been trying to get physically fit and working out, doing some different things. And in the last year, I joined a gym, and I still am not the picture of physical perfection at all. And so when I walk into the gym tomorrow morning, could you imagine for a second if I walked into the gym and there's a trainer at the door, and as I walk in, the trainer says, sorry, sir, you're not fit enough to work out at our gym. Like, we need people who are fit coming in here. You're not measuring up. We're not going to allow you in. We need people who are fit working out at our gym. We say, what do you mean? I'm the person that needs this the most. Like, I'm the one that needs to be exercising. I'm the one that needs to be doing cardio. I'm the one that needs to be there working out. Not the people that are already the physical specimens where they want to be. Not they don't need to work out. They still do. But I'm the one who needs it the most. And yet for years, churches have sat here, and it's not what they've meant to say. They've not put their arm out and said, sorry, you're not welcome here. But what they've done is said, we want to have our holy huddle. We want to have people who are spiritually pretty strong so we can enjoy each other's company. And because that's really safe, and because it's really clean and it's not a mess, we can come in here and do our thing. And if someone who is broken and lost comes in, we don't say this, but it's the response of the churches in our country to say, sorry, you don't quite measure up. Samuel does that. Like, he doesn't intend to do it, but Samuel looks at Eliab and he says, surely this is God's anointed. Like, surely the person walks in this morning, they come in and they got everything together. They have it all together. And we say, surely that must be the person who's supposed to be the spiritually qualified one. And God says, no, I'm used to taking broken people, taking people who are lost and who absolutely need grace, and fixing them and transforming them so they could be the difference makers in our world. And God did it throughout the Bible, and Jesus picks his disciples, picking some of the very same people, saying that character is not a physical thing. Second thing, character also isn't obvious. Character is not always obvious. He looks at Eliab and he says, this isn't the one, it isn't the right one. Then it says, then Jesse, the father, verse 8, called Abinadab and made him pass before Samuel. And he said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. Then Jesse made Shema pass by, and he said, neither has the Lord chosen this one. Jesse made seven of his sons pass before Samuel. And Samuel said to Jesse, the Lord has not chosen these. Then Samuel said to Jesse, are all your sons here? He said, there remains yet the youngest, but behold, he is down, he is keeping the sheep. And Samuel said to Jesse, send and get him, for we will not sit down till he comes here. Character isn't always obvious. See, even his dad, Jesse, is there, and Samuel says, go and get your sons. And so he gets all the sons that it seems obvious. Okay, if one of these is going to be anointed as to be the next king, it just makes sense. It's one of these older sons. They're grown up, they're strong, they're mighty. Surely it's not going to be David. Like, that's not the obvious choice. David is the one. He's the run of the litter. He's the one that no one is really paying attention to. He's kind of a little bit of a pretty boy. Like, he's not the rough warrior that Israel's going to need to be king. And so because of that, his own dad says he's not good enough. His own dad says he's not the one that God is going to choose. And so Samuel comes, he starts to pick through the different sons. He says, no, this isn't the one. No, this isn't the one. No, this isn't the one. Surely you must have more sons than this. And finally Jesse says, well, yeah. There's the one that's out watching the sheep. And it doesn't say this. But I wonder what was going through the mind of the other sons. Like, they're gathered together. And maybe they're the big, strong type, and they're all gathered together, and they think it's going to be Eliab, and it's not Eliab. And then they start to go through, maybe it's him, and maybe it's him. And each time the older sons are coming up, they're thinking, man, if he anoints me, I'm going to be the next king. And so it's not the other son in front of them, maybe that, man, this is my chance. No, it's not him either. And finally, these other sons gather together. Samuel says, but you have another son, right? There must be another son. And I wonder if they started to laugh a little bit. Yeah, there's still David, but he's out watching the sheep. Like they're kind of, I almost get this picture, and the Bible doesn't say this, but I almost get this picture, that they're kind of laughing and ridiculing, saying, surely it's not David. Like, there has to be somebody else. Character isn't always obvious right away. But God is saying, I'm not looking at the outward appearance. I'm not looking at the past history. I'm saying that there is something still there, that it looks like these people are unqualified, but I'm telling you they're qualified. It looks like David isn't the right one to be king, but I'm telling you that he is. Maybe you're where you're at spiritually right now because you've had family members in the past say, you're not ready for this. This task is too big for you. You want to take next steps spiritually? I'm telling you, you're not ready for those next steps. And you've had your own family, the ones who are supposed to love and support you, tell you, no, you don't want to do that. No, you're not ready for that. And so because of that, even as we became adults, we felt like when it came to our spiritual journey, we were still children. We felt like we weren't qualified to lead. We felt like we weren't qualified to fix our marriages, to beat the addictions, to fight for our families. We felt like, man, there's no way I can't do that. I've been told my whole life I'm not good enough by my family. I've been told my whole life I'm not good enough by the church. And so because of that, at some point, I started to believe this idea that I am not good enough. And God says, that's exactly the type of broken person that I want to transform their life and I want to change and see them take next steps to be the very thing they've been told for the longest time that they cannot be. Because for much of our life, character isn't obvious. It's not obvious to people around us. It's not obvious to our family. Sometimes it's not even obvious to ourselves. We get challenged spiritually and we kind of put our head down and we think, well, this can't be me. My life's broken. You know, I thought my family's going to be like this, and it's not like that, and now I don't know what to do. I feel ridicule, and I feel shame. God's character isn't always obvious, but working through that, working through this idea that we're going to move from thinking that who we are defines us to the point that our character defines us, and our character is going to start to impact and interact with who we are. See, those things are true. We read the rest of the story. He sent him. He sent for David, brought him in. Now he was ruddy. He had beautiful eyes and was handsome. Like I said, he's somewhat of a pretty boy. Not what you expect to be, the king of Israel, that was a warrior. And the Lord said, arise, anoint him, for this is he. David comes, the one who didn't have strong stature. David comes, the one who everyone else thought he wasn't good enough. When he comes, God speaks to Samuel and says, arise, anoint him, that's the one. For some of you this morning, God might be sitting saying, this is your time. And you've been told no long enough. It's time for God to speak in your life and say, yes, this is the time. Now is the time. It says, verse 13, Samuel took the horn of oil, anointed him in the midst of his brothers. And the Spirit of the Lord rushed upon David from that day forward. Samuel rose up and went to Ramah. Character isn't physical. Character is not always obvious. And the final thing is character produces consistency. The first story to follow this, right after David is anointed to become king, David ends up being put in service. Saul has no idea at this point David's been anointed to be king. That's going to bring some friction later on in their life. But right now, Saul has no idea he's been anointed to be king. And so David is anointed to be king. And ironically, David is called into service to serve the still present king. Saul has been unanointed, but he's still serving as king. And David is called in to serve. Now, David's character is such that even in that situation, when he has information, he's privy to information that his own king isn't privy to, he doesn't walk into the kingdom. He doesn't walk in and say, hey, I'm the new king. Get out of my way. He comes in as a servant. And he served Saul, that even in the moments when Saul is going through this almost depression because he realizes his anointing is gone and that God's Spirit has left him, it's actually David playing his musical instrument, that brings Saul out of those foul moods. David says, until it's God's time, I'm going to continue to serve. And later on when there gets to be friction, when Saul becomes aware of who the next king is, he eventually tries to kill David. And David says, no, I'm not going to touch him. Like, he's still the king, and I'm going to honor him as such. The character that God saw out of David's life was so strong that even when the pressure came, that character stayed consistent because the character in his life produced consistency. Now let me speak real quick to those who say, but JJ, you don't understand. Like, my past is so powerful in my life that I don't think I can get past it. Like, JJ, I know what you're saying, and I should beat those addictions, I should beat those hangups, but you don't know, man, it's Sunday morning, but you don't know what I did last night on Saturday night. Like, all those addictions are real, and I'm fighting them, but they're real. And I went some places last night I shouldn't have gone. Or I watched some things last night that I shouldn't have watched. And those things, they're so powerful in my life that I want to get past them. But when I get to the present, I'm still hung up on them. Listen to me for a second. The past isn't the past if it's impacting our present. It's no longer our past if all that stuff in the past is still impacting the decisions I'm making today. Then at some point, we got to crash that box and say, I'm the one allowing myself to be put in this box because I keep telling myself I'm a victim to my past and I can't get past that. And God says, and Jesus says, that's the very thing I died for, was to separate your past from who you are today. Those things no longer define you. That if you confess your sins, God is faithful and just to forgive those sins entirely and to cleanse you and to make you free. And to say, that's no longer who I am. Now, there's a voice in the back of our head that keeps telling us, that is who you are. And we got to fight that and say, no, that's not who I am. That's who I was. But praise God through what he's done in my life, that's no longer who I am. Now, somebody at this point should be cheering like it's a football game. Like, that is not my past anymore. Like, this is where I came from, but this is where I've come to. And that past isn't where I'm at anymore. And God is in the business of totally transforming our lives. Taking people who are unqualified. Taking people who we say, we don't deserve this. Listen, that's what grace is about. God wrecks our old life and gives us a fresh new perspective. A fresh new life. So I'm going to take people, a bunch of people who are unqualified. Who don't fit in. I'm going to call them to do great things. I'm going to take people who are broken and fragmented. I'm going to fit those pieces back together through my grace and make a complete picture. See, I know that. I know that story's crazy, but I know that. Because back when my wife and I were first married, we got a phone call from a Christian community center that was right outside a housing project. And so we're looking for a couple. We're seniors in college. And so we're looking for a couple to come in this year and to serve as program directors for this Christian community center. And like I said, it was right outside the housing project. The housing project was 99% African American. This was the two of us at that point. First of all, we were babies. But we're also about as pale as you can possibly be. And they called us and said, we want you guys to come and interview. And we interviewed. And the next day, they let us know the job's yours if you want it. And really, the idea was we were going to serve for a year while we finished up college and then move on to what was next. Every other program director they'd had done that for a year and moved on to seminary. We finished up our first year there, and God had given us such a passion for that community. But we went to them and said, there's actually a seminary in this area that I could go to if you'd allow us to stay for another year, and then another year, and then another year. We were there for 4 or 5 years, and we loved that season of our life. But about 2 years in, we had a Christmas dinner, Christmas party with our board of directors who'd hired us. It was actually the husband of one of the board of directors that was there at the first interview. His name was Ed. And during that Christmas party, we're kind of talking about the past year and some really cool things that happened at the community center. And Ed kind of confided in us at that point. And he said, hey, guys, I got to be honest with you. When we hired you guys, you're wet behind the ears. You look scared to death being in this new, like we were newly married and trying to figure out life, having no idea what life had to offer. And he said, when we hired you guys, I said, they're not going to last 2 weeks. And he said, now it's been 2 years, and we were signing on for another year. And, And I thought about that later on, because there are some people this morning that are trying to take steps in their spiritual growth. They're trying to say, man, I have traction. I want to do this, and I want to make sure that I follow through on this. And good, well-intentioned people say, I give it 2 weeks. Like, I know that you're trying, and I know that you want to fix your life. I know that you want to salvage your marriage. I know you want to do all those things, but I give it 2 weeks. And 2 weeks, you're going to go back to the old life. 2 weeks, you're going to go back to those old habits. 2 weeks, you're going to go back to just not caring about what God's doing in your life. And we have all the doubters and all the naysayers that say, you can't do this. You're not good enough to do this. And they're saying, we're giving it 2 weeks before you back off. And we're saying now, no, I know I'm not qualified, but the very idea of me not being qualified is what qualifies me. That Jesus takes broken people and he says, I'm going to fix them up and I'm going to use them to accomplish crazy things. And that's not just my story, that's your story. That God could take the brokenness of our lives and bring completion and change us. As long as you and I are willing to take next steps. Would you pray with me? Now, if you've been around Ridgepoint for a while, you'll know I'm not one that's really big on long, drawn-out invitations. But I also believe that every time that we approach the Bible, every time we approach a message, there's an invitation for us to respond. And I think it's especially appropriate this morning as we get ready to launch out in this series to give us a chance to respond. Maybe for you right now, you've been sitting here saying, man, I've been fighting this idea. I know Jesus loves me. I know that he cares about me, and I know that he wants me to be his. But I've been fighting this idea that he actually loved me and saved me because of my past. God's Spirit spoke to me this morning and said, this is a day that I'm supposed to stop fighting. I'm supposed to give my life to him and call upon Jesus as my Savior to come and to save my life. If that's you, that's your next step. Maybe for you, you made that decision, and that's as far as it went. You said, I know I made that decision privately. Maybe it was in the corner of my own home, and no one knew, but I made that decision to truly follow Jesus. But I've never done anything with that. The very first step of obedience for a person who chooses to follow Jesus is to follow him in baptism. Maybe for you, the next step is, man, I'm supposed to get baptized. I know I've been fighting this, but I'm also supposed to get baptized. We're actually having baptism next Sunday morning. You don't have to shoot a video or any of that stuff. We're just going to baptize people next Sunday morning. We'd love to invite you to be part of that as well. Or maybe your next step, it doesn't fit into a neatly defined box like that. But you know it's time to take some sort of next step in your life. You know that something's been holding you back. The enemy's been trying to beat you down and say you're not good enough and that you're not qualified to take those next steps. But you're saying, I know I'm supposed to take a next step, whether it's salvation, whether it's baptism, or whether it's just another next step in my spiritual journey. There are some people that are supposed to take next steps this morning. So I'm going to ask you not to embarrass you, but I'm asking you this morning to be bold. In just a second, the Bible talks about that if we confess Jesus before men, he'll confess us before the Father. But if we deny him before men, he'll deny us before the Father. So nobody else looking around, I'm asking you to do this. In just a second, I'm going to count to three. When I get to three, if God's calling you to take some sort of next step this morning, I'm just going to ask you right where you are just to stand up. I'm not going to ask you to do anything else, but just take a stand right now and say, yes, I know God has called me to take whatever that next step is in my life. If you're willing to take that next step, on the count of three, I want you to stand. One, two, three. Awesome. Anybody else? All right. Now this time I want the rest of the church to stand with them, to join with them in standing as I pray over them. this group. God, I thank you that you take the brokenness of our life. And God, you transform that broken mess of our life into a beautiful masterpiece. God, I thank you that you take that which looks unredeemable, that looks like it has nothing of value. And God, you give us so much value. God, for this group that stood this morning saying they're ready to take next steps, God, I pray for passion and for boldness in their lives to pursue you with everything that they have and to stop looking back and not to let fear stand in the way any longer. God, that we as a church would be caught up in the boldness of what you're doing. And that, God, we would never look back, but we'd say, God, we want you to transform us individually so that you transform us collectively. God, that you do something so mighty in our midst that people would look back and say, it is obvious that God is at work and that God is changing people's lives. And God, as it happens, we just want to celebrate who you are and what you're doing. For it's your son's mighty name we pray. Amen.